Shabbat shalom, brothers and sisters. This is Melvin. I trust you're being blessed real good today. And this Saturday afternoon, I'm just having a conversation with myself, and I'm trying to explain my excitement to me. You know, I mean, it's a day. It's a beautiful day. I mean, where I am, I mean, the sky is blue and the weather is nice and breeze coming through the window. So in Vista, California, I know it's not beautiful in a lot of places, but where I am, it's beautiful. It's a lovely day. But, you know, there's a lot of lovely days these days in terms of the weather. So not particularly, that doesn't explain the excitement. it's been 2 days, 2 days, 3 days since July 17th, and so this is not my first rodeo in terms of having a day come and go, a date come and go, and when I just knew in my heart of hearts that he would come and get us. It's been different for some reason this time, and I'm more thrilled than ever. I'm more excited than ever. And as I was trying to explain to me what this excitement could be all about, a song popped in my head. I think one of old Etta James' classics. It's The Nearness of You, but the first thing that came up when I was searching for The Nearness of You was Norah Jones. So I think she will help me explain to me and maybe to you my excitement. Well, we're gonna get into what happened next after the rooster crow, but I just want to share this excitement with me and you. She says it's not the pale moon that excites me. That thrills and delights me. What could it be? It's just the nearness of you. Could be the nearness. That could explain the excitement. She said, it isn't your sweet conversation that brings this sensation. No YouTube videos. It's just the nearness. I could explain it. That might explain it. When you're in my arms, and I feel you so. Don't you long to be close to him? Close enough to see him as he is and touch him and feel him and I need no soft lights to enchant me. If you will only grant me the right to those who believed on him, the right to become the sons of God, the right to hold you ever so tight, and to feel in the night. Now that might get me a YouTube strike, but that explains my excitement. He's too near to be depressed. He's too near to be stressed. He's too near to be anxious about anything. I think explains my excitement. And there will be signs and sun and the moon and stars, and upon the earth dismay among nations in perplexity at the roaring of the sea and the waves. Men fainting from fear and the expectation of the things which are coming upon the world, and for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. But when these things begin to take place, straighten up and lift up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. So I'd like to think this excitement is somehow tied to the fact that our redemption is drawing near. What happened next? I think we've been looking at that. What happened next after the rooster crowed? Because that's where we are right now. Every encounter that Jesus had after the rooster crowed was to affirm his grace, his love, his mercy for his disciples, and to encourage them to keep going until the gathering in Galilee. And every encounter was unique. And I think that what happened then is instructive for us now. And it would help, I think, to bring us together rather than tear us apart. Who you were and where you were after the rooster crowed . What happened next? Well, that depended on who you were and where you were. Not all the disciples were in the same place, not physically, not spiritually. For all of them, like all of us, had only but a measure of faith. God is bringing all of us, according to the Ephesians letter, to all of us to a maturity, till we all come to the to a mature knowledge, till we all come to the same place. But we haven't all come to the same place yet, and they hadn't all come to the same place yet. Jesus didn't happen at the same time in the same way to his disciples. Jesus did not happen at the same time and in the same way, in the same manner to his disciples. And that in and of itself helps us as we plug in to the story, as we plug into the script. And again, I'm grateful that the timeline has helped me to focus on the script. And in order to understand and appreciate the script, you always have to be in the scripture. Okay, so let's go to scripture to see this important lesson, I believe, that Jesus wanted to teach us. Something special happened in John, the 20th chapter. Let's start, let's pick it up where we left off. John chapter 20, chapter verse 18. Mary Magdalene came and announcing to the disciples, I have seen the Lord, and that he has said these things to her. Again, the first message, that's important because he was going to, and if you haven't yet, and that part of my excitement is about what Brother Mike was sharing over at Humble Seeker. And if you haven't heard his latest video, then you're to yourself to do that, and it'll excite you like this, like it excited me. Yeah. Verse 19 says, and when therefore it was evening on that day, and this is why I appreciate what Mike has said, because Mike goes into the twilight of the evenings and what that means and how that's important. And you know, the Christine's timeline talks about the twilights, and Mike just, you know, he leaves no question, and he just does a great job. I think you'll be blessed about that. But when therefore it was evening on that day, this is the day that he was resurrected. This was the evening of that first day. So he was resurrected on the third day. And so if it's the evening, that he's going into the fourth day. Evening of the third day, going into the fourth day. Listen to Pearl's, Sister Pearl's last video, and then Selah. Selah. Evening of the third day, going into the fourth day. When the doors were shut where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. Let me just, I don't want to get preachy right here, but don't fear man who was able to just kill the body, but you need to fear the one who is able to destroy. This is what Jesus says. You need to fear the one who is able to destroy both body and soul in hell. And the script is just playing out like it's played out here. Jesus' disciples were fearful of the religious Jews, fearful of the religious establishment, fearful of what the religious world was saying and threatening. Don't be fearful. Be faithful. And okay, that don't cost you nothing. That just, yeah. But Jesus came, it goes on to say, and stood in their midst and said to them, peace with you. Peace with you. I'm here. I'm back. It's me, the Prince of Peace is here. No need to fear the religious establishment. The Prince is here. Peace. You know, that's what I have, that's what I'm grateful for right now. You know, I'm not troubled, I'm not worried, I'm not frantic. Oh, he didn't come, oh, is he, you know, this is another day that's come and gone, and, you know, is he coming, when he coming? You know, the Holy Spirit just set me down you know, this morning and says, you know, do you believe that God knows what he's doing? And, you know, duh, of course he knows what he's doing. And conversation over. Sometimes we have those short conversation over. Okay, you know what you're doing. All right, it's cool. peace. That's what we need right now. A peace that surpasses all understanding. A peace that surpasses the dates that come and go. A peace that surpasses the all of the ugly stuff that is on, you know, in the YouTube watchman community. A peace that surpasses all understanding. A peace. Jesus came and stood in their midst. The same Jesus who in Revelation chapter 1 says he stood in the midst. He stands in the midst of the seven candlesticks. The first words out of his mouth to his church, to his disciples, huddled up in their disappointment and their fear. Peace is here. Peace be with you. And when he had said this, he showed them both his hands and his side. The disciples, therefore, rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And Jesus, therefore, said to them again, peace is here. This is the second time he said it. Before he says anything else, I'm here. Peace. As the Father has sent me, I also send you. I have an assignment. That's why I'm excited, because I believe we're so much closer to our assignment. You know, when we get to the gathering, when we get to our Galilee, that's when it begins in earnest. The assignments, the wedding supper, the And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. Something special happened, but somebody was missing. If you forgive the sins of any, their sins have been forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they have been retained. If I was one of his disciples, man, I would have wanted to be there to get that blessing. I mean, that was something. To have Jesus saying, receive the Holy Spirit. It's not all of the disciples were there to receive that, but the Bible focuses our attention on one that wasn't there. But Thomas, verse 24, but Thomas, one of the 12 called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. I don't know where he was. I don't know what he was doing. The Bible doesn't give us that 411, but we do know that he was not with them. He was not in the same place doing the same thing, experiencing the same thing. Jesus didn't happen at the same time in the same way to his disciples. Not then and not now. The other disciples, verse 25, the other disciples therefore were saying to him, we have seen the Lord. I get the sense when it said we were saying to him, the tense is that they were trying to convince him. I mean, the two disciples from Emmaus, I mean, they had come back. I mean, they got up from dinner and ran back to Jerusalem, and they were here in this during this meeting, and they were trying to, we have seen the Lord. We talked with him, we ate with him, and man, he shared with us. He opened up our understanding of the scriptures, and we have seen him. And Mary Magdalene was there, and the other Mary, we have seen the Lord. But Thomas, he says, unless I shall see in his hands the imprint of the nails and put my finger into the place of the nails and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. Let's read it like this. Unless I want to believe, but until I'm close enough, And maybe what the last couple days was about was God trying to get us close enough. Till I'm close enough to see the imprint of the nails and put my finger into the place of the nails and put my hand into his side so I can believe. You know, Jesus wants all of us to come to our own sense of knowing. I know in whom I have believed. I know, but he wants you to know. I know in whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Paul knew, I know, but God wants you to know and all the disciples to know. And Thomas said, I want to know, but I will not believe until I'm close enough. And I like verse 26 goes on. It says, and after 8 days, again, his disciples were inside, and Thomas with them now. 8 days later. Jesus came, and the doors having been shut, and stood in their midst and said, peace, peace. By now, we ought to understand how much God wants us to understand and how much he wants us to know, that to have this peace, a peace that surpasses all understanding, because he is our peace. Peace with you. Then he said to Thomas, this is what you wanted. This is the desire of your heart. To be close enough to see for yourself with your own eyes. Reach here your finger and see my hands, and reach here your hand and put into my side, and be not unbelieving, but believing. And Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. What happened next? Jesus made cameo appearances to his disciples, bringing each of them to another level, a greater measure of faith. And Thomas was given the desire of his heart. And maybe if that's the desire of your heart, to know him for yourself, to know him, to know his nearness, to know that your redemption is drawing near, not because somebody says it is, but because you're nearer enough to know that it is. Well, you can say, my Lord, and my God. Jesus said to him, because you have seen me, have you believed? Blessed are they who did not see and believed. I may not have all of the exciting experiences that people are sharing. In these last days, as God is pouring out his spirit, I'm not getting all these exciting dreams and visions and, you know, amazing revelations. But what I have now, his grace is sufficient.
It's not the pale moon. That excites me.
That thrills.
That
and delights me. I figured it out though.
Oh no.
It's just the nearness of you. Our redemption draws nigh. Beloved, Shabbat Shalom.